Decoys historically have been used by many people around the world for hunting, to attract birds in, to harvest them. But the use of decoys to talk to puffins, to communicate with puffins and let them know this place is a safe, protected space for them, really originated with this project in the 1970s. Project Puffin really started with a scientist, Dr. Steve Kress, and he was definitely taken with the idea of trying to bring puffins back. We had almost completely lost puffins in Maine as much as 100 years ago. And so in the early 70s, he formed a plan. That plan involved bringing puffin chicks, we often call them pufflings, down from a large, still healthy colony quite a ways north in Canada, in Newfoundland, and translocating them when they were just a few days old, basically flying them down to Maine, and then hand-rearing them, hand-feeding them fish just like their parents would for 6 or 7 weeks until they were old enough to leave an island and go out and feed themselves, grow up. After a period of waiting, a lot of persistence, a lot of hard work, adult puffins started coming back to the island. It took a little while, though, for them to get comfortable coming ashore. Puffins are really a water bird. They spend the majority of their year and their lives out in the water, not coming to land at all. But when they nest, they do come to land. They are a little cautious. If they don't see other puffins on shore, they're kind of reluctant to be the first bird out of the water. So one tool that was thought of to help them be a little more comfortable and confident was the use of decoys that look like puffins and set those up on the island. That made puffins a lot more comfortable. They started coming ashore, and within a couple of years after that, they started nesting at Eastern Egg Rock. They're not fooled forever. They do start to recognize, hey, that bird's not really moving around or interacting with me. And we use a couple other techniques to provide kind of enhanced stimulation. One of those is just a mirror box. So basically it sets up a mirror so that birds can see a reflection of themselves, so that when they move, that image moves. And so they get the sense of some activity. And then another kind of key stimulus is sound and recorded calls. And that, for many species, makes a huge difference. Decoys can attract them to land, but then the sound, which is played often continuously, nonstop, that really helps them feel like, yes, there is activity here. There are real birds. So we actually manufacture decoys for projects around the world that happen. You can see a lot of decoys behind me here. And around a third of all the seabird species in the world have benefited from the use of social attraction, we call it, including some of the most critically endangered species in the world that people are working very hard to recover. We went from just having a handful of puffins, probably less than a dozen puffins in the state of Maine that were nesting. Now we have close to 3,000 puffins that nest here in Maine. It kind of, you know, has just gradually kept increasing. We're still seeing increases. One of the islands where puffins nest here in Maine, the Seal Island National Wildlife Refuge, had a record number of puffins nesting this year. So we still keep getting good news about the population here. Puffins are experiencing some challenges. What we've seen that we're most concerned about in the long term is their food supply. Puffins eat small fish, and here in the Gulf of Maine, one of the most common fish that they've eaten historically or over the history of our project is Atlantic herring. And climate change is really impacting that fish, both just how many Atlantic herring are out there and where they are spending their time. And so when we see these marine heat waves, puffins really have to adjust to a very different kind of food situation than they experienced historically. And so we've seen puffins struggle to find enough fish to feed their chicks and successfully raise chicks. We're using the data, the information on what they eat, the fish that they eat, kind of sharing that information, that data that we've collected over many years with people that manage fish populations. And we're trying to help us understand how fish populations are doing, and in particular fish like Atlantic herring, and give them a better idea of how they should set harvest levels so that there are enough fish both for puffins and other seabirds and for people to harvest. Another big initiative that we're working on right now is tracking where birds go, both when they're feeding chicks, like where do they go out in the Gulf of Maine, our immediate offshore piece of the ocean, and then also where do they migrate, where do they go during the winter, what's their routes to and from those places. The winds are often quite strong and consistent out in the ocean, so it's an important place to try and generate cleaner energy. But of course, we don't want to put a lot of wind turbines in places that are really important for seabirds. So we're trying to document and understand those important places for seabirds and protect those, along with identifying places that are less important that would be good places for these wind farms. One aspect of our work with puffins and other seabirds here in Maine is really sharing that experience with other people. And that happens in a variety of ways. Each year, we have a big number of young biologists come work with us. They live out on these nesting islands all summer. They don't come back to shore. They don't get a shower. They don't get to use plumbing. But they are really key to ensuring every summer is a success for the puffins and other birds. One important objective for our program here is, in addition to protecting birds and ensuring these bird populations persist, is to kind of bring along the next generation of scientists and conservationists that will take this work forward. We're also, you know, very excited to share these birds with the general public. Webcams are a great opportunity for folks to watch a chick grow up over the course of 6 or 7 weeks, and even, you know, watch the parents incubate the egg before that. We have naturalists on tour boats, Audubon naturalists on tour boats that go out and circle a nesting island and see puffins in the water or on the shore at their nesting island. We have an educational camp here in coastal Maine where people can come and visit and learn more about the coastal ecology here and the birds. So we're really very committed to not only doing this work, but, you know, sharing the wonder, the joy of puffins, and, you know, really hoping that inspires people to, you know, think about conservation wherever they happen to be.